بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. The chapter that we're going to talk today about is going to be from the الرسالة القشيرية في التصوف. الرسالة في التصوف of Imam al-Qushayri. It is a book that we have been reading chapters from for about more than a year now, probably 2 years. And the chapter that we'll talk about today, it is about trust in God, or as it is known in Arabic, as we hear it often in Arabic, the word tawakkul, trust in God. The chapter is very long. Therefore, it is impossible for me today to cover the whole chapter, even though I'm not reading sentence by sentence. I'm selecting only certain passages through the chapter. But even doing that, it is impossible for me to cover the whole chapter since it's very long. Therefore, today I'm going to talk about only a section of this chapter, and then inshallah next time we will cover the rest of it. Before we start reading the chapter and commenting about the statements of Imam al-Qushayri, ayahs from the Quran, hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the statements of many other awliyas, we need to bear in mind that a lot of people, they don't have the right understanding of what tawakkul is. A lot of people think that you have to rely completely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you have to neglect everything else that goes on in your life. And this is what they believe, that this is the true achievement of tawakkul, reliance or trust in God. And that's a false conviction. That is not the true conviction. The true conviction is the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is mentioned in this chapter as well, that goes through the chapter, where Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that you tie the camel and then you put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means that you have to put your effort first. And once you put your effort, then depend on Allah, put the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which results to whatever comes at the end, whether it is good or whether it is bad. After you have done your work, after you have shown your efforts, you have to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is bringing you the future of that effort. And you have to agree with that. You have to be in peace with that. You have to leave it up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have done your work, that's it. Leave it up to Him. Be in peace with that. Be satisfied with whatever the result is going to come out of that. So this is the true understanding, even though this is not the whole thing, but I'm just giving you only a little bit out of it so you can at least have the right opinion. You can have the right conviction within your mind about what truly tawakkul is. Now we're going to go over some of the verses of the Quran here that Imam al-Qushayri starts his chapter with, and he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whosoever puts his trust in God, He will suffice him. وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلَ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Whosoever puts his trust in God, He will suffice him. And he also mentions another verse from the Quran where he says, let those who believe trust in God. So in a way, the quality of the believers is that they trust in God. And the other verse says, put your trust in God if you are believers. وَتَوَكَّلُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. So if you really want to display this attribute, this characteristic of being a believer, then make sure you're putting your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Imam, right away, after mentioning the verses from the Quran, he starts with a hadith of our blessed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, where he states that this hadith is narrated from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is reported to have said, I was shown all the communities at the gathering place of the Hajj. I saw that my community had filled the plain and the mountain. I was able to see the community, my followers, my ummah, and I saw that my ummah has filled all the space pretty much. Their number and appearance pleased me. I was asked, are you content? Are you happy? Are you satisfied? And I said, yes, I'm satisfied with the number of the people that I see. Together with them will be 70,000 who will enter paradise without reckoning. Allah make us among those. Ameen. They never had themselves tattooed, nor sought omens in birds, nor uttered spells. Rather, they trusted in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People back in the days, they used to put tattoos. Well, they still do it nowadays as well. But one of the reasons that they would put tattoos was to symbolize their deity that they used to worship. Therefore, in Islam, is not only prohibited having a tattoo simply because the skin becomes covered with that, and when the water of ablution, the wudu or ghusl, falls upon it, it doesn't touch the skin. That's not the only reason, but also it is something that people back in the days used to do to worship their deities. So in order to remember their deities, their idols, they would put it on their arm, on their chest, or in different parts of the body, so they can be reminded, and they can also, in front of the people, they can be seen as a community or as a person who belongs to that certain idol or that certain deity that they used to worship. Therefore, in Islam, it is prohibited. This is one of the reasons that tattoo as well, it is prohibited in Islam. So, it is said to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that these are people who had no tattoo, meaning that their faith was pure, their aqidah, their creed was pure. And they did not sought omens, superstitions, what nowadays people are. A lot of them are about superstitions. They see the place where future tellers, they have a business nowadays. They make money out of that. In every corner you go, every city you go here, you see, you know, future teller stores. You pay them money, they tell you what's going to happen in the future. And this used to be, and it is nowadays, very spread. So rather than all of these things, they used to trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They used to really rely upon Him. So this hadith clearly states that reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admits somebody in paradise. And it makes a person, since they were so trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it made them be a part or be one of the 70,000 people who are going to enter paradise without any reckoning. Then Uqasha bin Muhsin al-Asadi stood up and requested, O Messenger of Allah, pray to God to make me one of them. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam prayed, O God, make him one of them. And we know that the prayer of the Prophet is not rejected. So Kasha, he was one of them. Then another stood up and said, pray to Allah to make me one of them. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam replied, Uqasha came ahead of you. He was before you. Hopefully Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered his request as well. Now, Imam goes on with the statements of scholars and the awliya of this deen, of this ummah. And by mentioning first Abu Ali al-Ruthbari, who relates that I said to Amr bin Sinan, tell me something about Sahal bin Abdullah, Imam Tustari, who is very famous for his tafsir, tafsir Tustari. So he said, I said to Sa'd bin Abdullah, he told me, he said that there are three signs of the one who trusts in God. Number one, he does not ask. He does not ask. Number two, he does not turn away anything. He does not ask people, give me this, I need you to give me this, I rely on you. No, that's not his personality. But at the same time, he does not reject people. If somebody comes to him asking him, can you do this for me? He does it. He does it with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has enabled him, whatever power he has given him, he does it. He answers back. An orphan comes and says, I need some money, he gives whatever he has. He doesn't return somebody empty-handed. He does not ask, and he fulfills the request of anyone who comes to ask to him. And the last quality is that he does not withhold anything. And also, Sheikh Tustari explained that the first station in trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that the servant be between the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exactly as the dead body is between the hands of the one who washes the dead. He turns him however he wishes. The person who is washing the body of the dead, he can turn that dead body as he wishes. And the dead body is not going to react. He's not going to say, hey, don't move me this way. No, because he's dead already. So that's how the servant of Allah needs to be in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. Needs to rely in Him 100%. Needs to give up his nafs. He needs to give up everything and let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take lead, take care over him. On the authority of Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, it is told that a man came riding his camel and he asked, O Messenger of Allah, shall I leave my camel untied and trust in God? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam replied, both, tie your camel and trust in God. This is what we mentioned earlier when we introduced the topic. Ibrahim al-Khawaz commented, whoever genuinely trusts in Allah when dealing with himself will also trust in God when dealing with other people. This is another higher stage that requires more work. But however, when somebody is able to leave his own affairs and the affairs of the others in the hands of Allah, when dealing with others, in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the true tawakkul. That is the true reliance on Allah jalla jalalu. When Ibn Atta al-Iskandari was asked about the true nature of trust in God, he explained, it is that anxious desire for things of the world should not appear in you, despite the severity of your need for them, and that you should always remain truly content with Allah, despite your dependence on those things. And this is one of the hard achievements for Muslims, especially living not in a poverty state, but in a place where you have everything in front of you. Muslims, they have everything in these in the Western world. In the Muslim countries, still a lot of those countries, they are third world countries, and they don't have, a lot of them are in poverty. But here you are being tested, because everything is in front of us. And our nafs always wants things. So this is related to the ability of you restraining your own nafs and saying no to certain things that are not necessary. Why would you like to spend money on things that are unnecessary? Why would you like to spend a lot of money in a car that is unnecessary for you to have? Why would you like to have a huge house that you're not going to use most of the rooms? Why you're going to spend so much money in worldly things? And you know that you are wasting the money. And why is that? That comes as a result of your own nafs, because your nafs wants that. You know? So restraining yourself, restraining that desire, not being anxious about these desires that you have in life, despite the severity of your need for them, and that you should always remain truly with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is the tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Abu Nasr al-Sarraj reported, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, as Abu Bakr al-Daqaq has said, restricting concern from livelihood to one day and refraining from aspirations for the narrow, this is the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nowadays, not only that we want to guarantee for the whole year that we have provision and we have money and all of that, but we have to have the 401ks, we have to have, you know, we dream so much that we're going to live here forever. And we neglect the statement of Imam Ali radiallahu anhu, akarramallahu wajhahu, where he says that live in this world, live for this world as you're going to die tomorrow. I'm sorry, live for this world as you're going to live forever. Live in this world as you're going to live forever means behave in a way that, you know, you're going to earn respect from people. You know, do things as you're going to live forever. Build up good character, build up good relations with people as you're going to live forever. But think about the akhirah as you're going to pass away tomorrow. So work for the akhirah as you're going to pass away tomorrow. And this concept is not in our minds, unfortunately. In our minds, we get so much preoccupied with what's going to happen after a month, after a year. You know, how are we going to build this? How are we going to do this? You know, and as a result of that, we neglect things that are necessary for today. And we're focused on what's going to happen in the future. We forget about the present and we get preoccupied with the future. So he says this very clearly, that trust in God is restricting concern for livelihood to one day and refraining from aspirations for tomorrow. Abu Ya'qub al-Nahrajuri remarked, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is perfect essence, is the state manifested by Ibrahim alayhi salam when he answered Jibreel's offer to help him. And he says, from you, I have no need, he said. Remember, he's referring to the time when Ibrahim was put in the fire. And at that moment, Jibreel came to him and he said, do you need any help? Let me help you. And the answer of Ibrahim was, no, he said. Not from you. As for you, I need no help, he said. The help I need is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he knows my situation. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Ibrahim alayhi salam, not to Ibrahim, but he commanded the fire, Ya naru kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. O fire, be peaceful and cold for Ibrahim. So this is the true trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of Ibrahim. And the scholar and the wali says that this is the perfect essence manifested by Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. And then Imam al-Qushayri quotes another statement from Sahal bin Abdullah, Imam Tustari, who mentioned, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the state of the Prophet. And earning is his sunnah. This is very important as well. Trust in Allah, tawakkul ala Allah, this is the state of the Prophet. This is the essence of the Prophet himself. This is the essence of his character. This is one of the essential parts of his character, that he was relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he's saying, for you, if you want to have the earning, that is the sunnah of the Prophet. You have to follow that sunnah. So whoever maintains his state will never abandon his sunnah. This rejects, now according to this, it rejects the... It rejects those people who say that we have to only rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do nothing. As some scholars, they mention, you know, when they talk about some Sufis, they say there are some Sufis nowadays that they pray during the night and they sleep during the day. But the true tasawwuf is praying during the night so you can be active during the day. So you can put that prayer to work during the day. That is the true tasawwuf. You know, not being among those who pray during the night and then sleep during the day. So this is a this statement, it automatically rejects that idea that, you know, leave everything, don't take care of your responsibilities, don't put your efforts in this world. And it clearly mentions that we have to be from those who follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do our share, give our share to this world in order to earn the hereafter. Because this world is a field. Whatever we put inside of the ground, we're going to see the fruits of that seed in the hereafter. So we have to treat this world in that way. If we don't put the seed, which means that if we don't put the efforts, then what are we going to see in the future? Well, what kind of fruits can you see? You will see no fruits. So we need to put our efforts. Umar bin Sinan, rahimahullah, related that Ibrahim al-Khawas passed by us. And we said to him, tell us about the strangest thing that you saw in your travels. Ibrahim al-Khawas was one of the great awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he was approached to tell them about what was the strangest thing. And he replied, Khidr alayhi salam met me. I believe everybody knows about Khidr. It is the man who was met, who Musa alayhi salam met during his lifetime. Just a reminder. So I met with Khidr alayhi salam, he says, and he asked me to keep me company. And I was afraid lest my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be corrupted by my staying with him. So I parted from him. Now meeting Khidr alayhi salam, it is not a chance that everybody has. This is a very special occasion. You know, it's like more than meeting a king, meeting somebody who is going to give you wisdom, meeting probably the person who has the most wisdom. Right? Even more than the Prophet. Prophet Musa alayhi salam, when he asked Allah, he said, Oh God, is there anybody smarter than me on earth? And Allah said, definitely, O Musa, there is somebody else. And I'm going to get you to meet with him. And he went, he traveled all the way so he can meet with him. And after he finished, after the experience that he had with Khidr alayhi salam, he realized that he knew things that Musa had no clue about. He knew secrets that Musa had no knowledge about. Remember when he killed the young child, when he destroyed when he opened the hole on the boat so the boat can sink, and when he built the wall. You know, Musa had no idea. He was, what are you trying? Why are you doing this? And he had no patience when he saw certain things that in front of him appeared to be major sins, like killing somebody or destroying somebody's wealth. But actually, in the reality, behind the scene, there was something that Musa did not know. You know, he did not know the secret behind that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Musa those secrets. So, appeared in front of Ibrahim al-Khawas, and he said, because... Now, this is the thing that we have to pay attention to this. Because I might lose that true reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being amazed with His knowledge, being amazed with His wisdom, and depending so much on that wisdom, maybe I might break some relations with the Creator. Because of that fear, I said, no, I'm sorry, I cannot accompany you. Not that he was better than Khidr, not that he's saying I'm better than me or anything like that. But because of the reliance on Khidr, you know, he was afraid that he was going to break that relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The master Abu Ali al-Daqaq, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon him, said, there are 3 degrees for the one trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, after Imam is giving us the definitions and how should a man trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is now giving us the categories. What are the degrees of somebody who trusts, who puts the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then he said that the first one is trust. The second one is surrender. And the third one is assignation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means to one's affairs. So you leave all of your affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first one was putting the trust to God. Now, Abu Ali al-Daqaq was one of the teachers of Imam al-Qushayri. So now Imam al-Qushayri, he comments this statement of his own teacher and he says, the one who trusts in God is at peace with his promise. Again, the one who trusts in God is at peace with his promise. The one who surrenders is content with his knowledge. The one who surrenders to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is content with his knowledge. And the one who assigns his affairs to Allah is satisfied with his wisdom. I heard him say, Imam al-Qushayri continues, I heard him say, his own teacher, Abu Ali al-Daqaq, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the beginning. Surrender is the middle. And assignation, one's affairs to God, is the end. And by having these 3 qualities, that means that you possess the true tawakkul ala Allah. Daqaq was also asked about trust, and he commented, it is eating without greed. What is a trust in God? It's eating without greed. He's saying something, actually, this statement is very simple, but also, we don't only eat food. We also eat wealth. The Quran also talks about it. وَتَأْكُلُونَ التُرَاثَ أَكْلًا لَمَّا You eat, metaphorically, not physically, but you eat the turath, you eat the inheritance of the people, of the orphans, poor people, whatever. You eat that inheritance, meaning that you consume that. But in Arabic, وَتَأْكُلُونَ أَكَلْ It is mentioned this word, eating, metaphorically used. So here too, when this master, Abu Ali al-Daqaq, when he says that it is eating without greed, it does not refer only to food. That is literally, which is true, when you see people eating, you know, with so much greed, that's not a good sign right there. But beside that, it is also consuming the wealth. It is also consuming other worldly possessions with greed and gaining them with greed. That is a bad sign. Sahal bin Abdullah, again, Imam Tustari stated, whoever criticizes activity in earning a livelihood criticizes the sunnah. And one who criticizes trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala criticizes faith. So saying that we should not put our efforts, but just rely on Allah, meaning we don't tie the camel, but we only rely on Allah, he is not fulfilling the sunnah. And the one who is not trusting, the one who is not relying on Allah, that person is not putting the faith into practice. There's no faith for that person. Ibrahim al-Khawwaz was without peer in trust in God. He had no similarity in tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He took great care in observing this tawakkul. He would never be without a needle and thread and a small bucket for ablution. Needle, thread, small bucket for ablution, and also scissors. These three things. He was asked, why do you, whenever you travel, whenever we see you, you have these three things with you. Thread, needle, scissor, and the bucket for water, for wudu. And he says, these kinds of things do not destroy trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because God subhanahu wa ta'ala has made religious duties binding on us. So these are essential things that we must have in order for us to fulfill these prayers and these duties. The darwish, he says, has but one robe, he says. He has one robe. And his robe may be torn. If he has no needle and thread with him, his private parts show. And his prayer is rendered invalid. So in order for him, you know, to stitch it back, the rope, he needs this. He needs the needle and the thread. And if he has no bucket for ablutions, then his purity is slight. So if so, you see a derwish without a bucket for ablutions or a needle and thread, then you should worry about the completeness of his prayer. If he, which means that if you see that a person is not really fulfilling the basic needs, and he's claiming to be a lover of God and to be in the path of tasawwuf and be so uplifted spiritually, don't buy that. If he's not able to fulfill these essentials. The master Abu Ali al-Daqqaq, may Allah be pleased with him, said, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the quality of the believers. Surrender is the quality of the saints, of the awliya. And assigning one's affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the quality of those who assert his unity, who are connected to the tawheed, and they live according to the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So trust in God is the quality of the common people. Surrender is the quality of the elite. And assigning one's affairs to God is the quality of the elite of the elite. I also heard him say, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the attribute of the prophets generally. Surrender is the attribute of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And assigning one's affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the attribute of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. One of the Sufis related, I was in the desert and I was proceeding ahead of a caravan. I saw someone in front of me, so I hurried to catch up with him. It was a woman. She was holding a staff, who was walking along slowly. Because I thought that she was feeble, poor woman, the way how she looked, I reached in my pocket, brought out 20 dirhams, and instructed, take these. Then wait until the caravan reaches you and hire a camel with this money. But she lifted her hand in the air. And suddenly there were dinars in her palm. Dirhams is a smaller amount. Dinars, it is a bigger amount of money. So he's giving something small to her, but all of a sudden she's opening her hands and she's saying, look what I have here. She has dinars in her hand. Even though she looked poor woman. And suddenly there were dinars. So she observed, she said, you pull dirhams from a pocket, but I pull dinars from the unseen. Which shows that she had this tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is the one who really provides for her. We leave it here, and inshallah in the future we continue with the rest of this chapter, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with His countless blessings, to forgive our sins, to make us from those who follow the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the advice of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the wisdom of the awliya of Allah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower with His mercy our scholars, our teachers who are guiders for us, and all of us who are present here today. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barik ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi اجمعين.